Welcome, everyone, to the Arent Fox Made in USA legal series. We welcome you to a discussion that we're having today with our featured guest speaker, Julia Solomon Ensor of the Federal Trade Commission. This is the first in a series that Arent Fox will be hosting, so this is our kickoff event for our Made in USA legal series. We are pleased to welcome over 230 attendees who are on the phone today. I think actually it's now about 240. Those attendees are from over 150 companies. We have representatives on the phone of an extraordinary cross-section of U.S. manufacturing, from aerospace and heavy machinery to personal care and apparel, from medical device manufacturers to food product distributors, as well as representatives from the entire supply chain of products, including retailers, distributors, wholesalers, importers, and manufacturers. We are also pleased to welcome representatives from some local government and state government. We are also pleased to welcome some foreign government representatives. You may want to mark your calendars for our next Made in USA webinar. It's going to be May 17th, 2017, at the same time as today, from 2 to 3 p.m. The agenda and the featured guest speaker will be announced shortly on our website. We are extremely pleased to have with us today's featured guest speaker, Julia Solomon Ensor. Julia is an attorney in the Enforcement Division of the Federal Trade Commission's Bureau of Consumer Protection. She coordinates the division's Made in USA program and works on a variety of compliance and enforcement matters related to Made in USA. I am Georgia Ravitz, an attorney with Arent Fox. I am one of your hosts today, along with my colleague, Scott Cohn. Today's topic will specifically be the FTC's policy on Made in USA. Julia will share with us an explanation of the Commission's enforcement policy, as well as share some examples of recent enforcement actions. One thing we would like to point out is that we see an overwhelming interest in this area, and we think it's due primarily to three things. One, extremely increased demand in the consumer marketplace. It's never been as high as it is today to purchase products with a Made in USA label. Secondly, our current administration. The administration has been clear that one of its top priorities is the increased manufacture of U.S.-made products. And finally, programs and like the Buy American Act that companies would like to take advantage of and, as such, need to understand the rules relating to Made in the USA.
Georgia, thank you. I'm Scott Cohn, and before we get started, I would like to review a few items. First, this webinar is being recorded, and due to the number of attendees on the call today, we have muted the participant lines to avoid any background noise. Now, the information presented during this webinar and answers to any questions that we provide during the webinar do not constitute legal advice from Arent Fox or any individual attorneys or from the Federal Trade Commission. The Made in USA issues we are discussing today are very fact-specific and require a close analysis of many factors from a legal, accounting, and consumer perception perspective. So the general principles and other information provided today should not be viewed as legal advice. Now, with respect to questions that we've received from participants, we are pleased to have received numerous excellent questions that we will present to Julia during our Q&A. Please note that no company names have been associated with those questions. And now, you can also submit questions in real time during this webinar through the chat box feature on the right-hand sidebar of the WebEx screen, and we will do our best to address those questions as well, time permitting. However, we have additional webinars planned, and we will try to address any overflow questions that we don't get to on today's call. So without any further ado, we would like to welcome Julia Ensor, who will give a brief presentation on FTC's enforcement policy on Made in USA claims and recent enforcement examples. And Julia will participate in our Q&A immediately following her presentation. Julia?
Thanks, Scott and Georgia. I really appreciate the kind introduction and the invitation today. Next slide, please. So today I'm going to talk about a few different things. I'm going to start with a little bit of background about the Federal Trade Commission and advertising law generally. Then we'll get more specifically into the enforcement policy statement on U.S. origin claims. But before I dive in, I have to give the obligatory disclosure. The views that I'm going to express today are my own, not those of any commissioner or the commission. Next slide, please. So first, by way of a little bit of background, I wanted to give you a little bit of information about the Federal Trade Commission. We are an independent agency with very broad jurisdiction over almost every sector of the U.S. economy. We're the only federal agency with general jurisdiction in the area of consumer protection. We're the nation's truth in advertising agency. And the primary statute that we enforce is the Federal Trade Commission Act, specifically Section 5, which declares unlawful, unfair, or deceptive acts or practices in or affecting commerce. Next slide, please. The Federal Trade Commission Act gives us authority to take action against false and misleading advertising claims, including claims about U.S. origin. The bottom line when you think about Section 5 is if you're going to make an advertising claim, tell the truth and make sure you can substantiate any and all claims that you make. So there are a few things that go into figuring out whether you're properly substantiating your claims. First of all, you need to understand which claims you and your products are actually making, and then you need to figure out how consumers understand those claims. So the standard that we look for substantiation for U.S. origin claims is a reasonable basis for the claim. And the enforcement policy statement on U.S. origin claims helps marketers comply with Section 5 in this area. So I think it's important to emphasize that the enforcement policy statement is not a law. It's not a rule. It's not independently enforceable. It's the Commission's interpretation of how it will interpret Section 5 as it pertains to U.S. origin claims. Next slide, please. So the enforcement policy statement applies to all forms of marketing. We're talking business-to-business marketing as well as business-to-consumers, product labels, ads, emails, everything. Almost all products that are advertised or sold in the United States are fall under the ambit of the enforcement policy statement, with the exception of products that are subject to other laws. So just a few examples of products that may be accepted would be certain textiles, wool and fur products, automobiles, certain food products, and government procurement. Next slide, please. The enforcement policy statement provides information for marketers on express and implied U.S. origin claims, qualified and unqualified. When I say express claims, I mean the claims that you're making through your words, made in USA, that's an express claim. Implied could be something that you suggest to consumers through a combination of words and imagery and things like that. We'll get a little bit more into unqualified and qualified claims, but just generally, an unqualified U.S. origin claim would be something like made in USA without any additional information. A qualified claim would contain information explaining what you mean by made in USA and disclosing the existence of imported content. When we look at U.S. origin claims, we apply what we call a net impression test. We're looking at the claim in context. We're looking at the words, the pictures, the overall design of the package or the claim in order to understand how consumers would interpret the claim, which is always the primary consideration from our perspective. U.S. symbols or geographic references, so we're talking flags, maps, and things like that, those may contain a U.S. origin claim in context, but again, we're going to be analyzing the claim as a whole. It is important to note that an American brand name trademark, or just your address alone probably does not convey a U.S. origin claim subject to the enforcement policy statement. Next slide, please. So I want to give you a few examples of what I'm talking about when I talk about unqualified claims. Obviously, if you're claiming that your product is made in the USA or made in America without any further information, those are unqualified U.S. origin claims. We found that consumers also understand other words to suggest unqualified U.S. origin claims. Examples, built in USA, produced in USA, manufactured, created, things like that can also convey an unqualified claim. Again, we're looking at the net impression to understand how the consumer will interpret the claim in context. Next slide, please. The enforcement policy statement provides that in order to make an unqualified U.S. origin claim, a marketer should be prepared to substantiate that the product is all or virtually all made in the United States. In order to figure out whether a product falls into that category, first, marketer needs to be able to substantiate that the final assembly and substantial transformation of the product took place in the U.S. The reason for that requirement is to avoid a conflict with customs rules and regulations. So it would be nonsensical for customs to require you to label your product as product of some other country, and then for the enforcement policy statement to say that there were a U.S. origin claim that you can make. So before you think about which U.S. origin claim would work for your product, the first step is to make sure that you are actually substantially transforming the product in the U.S. Once you cross that initial hurdle, then the commission applies a flexible factors analysis. Next slide, please. The analysis the commission applies is very fact-specific, very product-specific. We look at any number of different factors depending on the context, but the three most common factors that we would look at will be the proportion of U.S. manufacturing costs versus foreign manufacturing costs. And there we're talking about cost of goods sold or inventory costs. We would look at how far back in the manufacturing chain the foreign content is. And we would look at the importance of the foreign content to the overall function of the product. The reason that we're looking at those three factors, again, is we're tied to consumer perception. And these are three things that consumers think about when they're thinking about U.S. origin claims. Next slide, please. So you might go through this analysis by yourself or with your attorney and determine, well, we're doing a lot of work in the U.S., but our product is not all or virtually all made in the U.S. Is there still a way that we can promote the work that we're doing here? And as long as you're substantially transforming your product in the U.S., the answer is probably yes. In this case, you might look to a qualified claim. So a qualified U.S. origin claim, as I was mentioning before, would be a claim like made in USA with additional language that describes the extent, amount, or type of domestic processing and indicates that the product's not entirely of U.S. origin. So, you know, something like made in USA with imported parts or something like that would convey to consumers that, yes, there is work that's going on in this product in the U.S. It's substantially transformed here, but it incorporates significant imported parts. Again, I can't emphasize this enough. To avoid those customs conflicts, however, you need to be sure that for any product, even with a qualified claim, the last substantial transformation is occurring in the U.S. Next slide, please. Once you've determined that you want to make a qualified claim for your product and you figured out what language you want to use, you need to understand that a qualification needs to be clear, prominent, and understandable to consumers. So, for example, if you've got a claim that says, made in USA in really large font with a giant flag and hammers and all kinds of imagery and stuff like that, it's probably not going to be effective to consumers for you to write in tiny, tiny print underneath with imported parts. Consumers are not likely to see that qualification. The claim may very well deceive people. The other question I get a lot at this point is, well, can my qualification be on a website? Can I refer to a website? The answer to that is no. It's basic FTC law that your qualification needs to be there with the claim that's being qualified. Reference to a website is not an effective way to qualify your claim. You can refer to a website to give consumers more information or things like that, but your qualification needs to be right there with the claim being qualified. Next slide, please. One example of a qualified claim is assembled in the USA. There, the substantiation for that claim would be substantial transformation in the U.S. So we're looking at principal assembly in the U.S. that's more than a screwdriver assembly. Next slide, please. So the program to enforce under Section 5 in this area is a little bit different than in some program areas of the FTC. So in this area, we provide a huge amount of informal staff counseling. Our goal is to work with companies like yours to help you develop truthful claims that promote the good work that you're doing in the U.S., that promote U.S. manufacturing, but don't deceive consumers in the process. So in order to do that, we take a lot of incoming phone calls and emails. We answer questions all the time. It's very normal to get calls from companies who want to describe their products and their processes, and we can give feedback on, you know, obviously non-binding informal staff opinion, but we can give feedback on how we as staff who practice in this area would think about these claims. We do monitor complaints that we receive in this area very carefully. We review all complaints that we receive. And then if we see complaints that are have basis and warrant further examination, then our first approach is typically to reach out to companies and try to counsel them into compliance. Our assumption in these cases comes from the baseline of you don't understand the enforcement policy statement, you need some help, not in most cases that you're actively trying to deceive consumers. So we do try to counsel companies and help them come into compliance with the law. If that process is successful, we issue closing letters on the public record. You can review a lot of those on our website. However, in some cases, that process might fall apart, or we might encounter a company that's engaged in such out-and-out fraud that that baseline assumption of not wanting to deceive consumers might not be the right one. And in cases like that, where people either ignore us or are committing fraud or there are other factors, we can proceed to litigation, either administrative litigation or federal court administration under Section 5. Next slide, please. In terms of closing letters, there's a selection of them from August 2010 to the present on our website. This slide says 99. It's actually 100. I issued one yesterday. Here's a link to where you can view the letters. These letters incorporate some guidance that might be helpful if you're thinking about qualified claims or other questions. Next slide, please. In terms of litigation, the two most recent litigation matters released by the Commission were released earlier this month and in February. These related to companies that were making unsubstantiated Made in USA claims, one for pulleys and one for water filtration systems. Next slide, please. Both of the orders in these cases include identical injunctive relief. Importantly, the orders say that the company should not make U.S. origin claims unless their products are either all or virtually all made in the USA. And there's some language in the order that gives some parameters on what that means that echoes what's in the enforcement policy statement. Or the company clearly and conspicuously qualifies their claims to convey the extent to which their products contain foreign parts, ingredients, or processing. The orders also contain provisions prohibiting misleading or unsubstantiated country of origin claims. Next slide, please. A few months ago, we settled a case in federal court with a company called Commence. This had to do with unqualified U.S. origin claims for products containing glue, super glue products containing a mix of imported and domestic chemicals. The relief in this case is very similar, but the case also incorporates what we call means and instrumentalities provision, which we can talk more about if people have questions, and also a monetary judgment. Next slide, please. Further back, just two cases that you should be generally aware of. In 2014, we had a case against a company called Made in the USA brand that awarded a certification mark to companies that self-certified compliance. So that's something to take a look at and think about if you're looking at certification programs or if you're offering a certification program. And then just another litigation example would be the EK accessories matter in 2013. Next slide, please. That's the end of my formal presentation today. I'll be answering all of the very thoughtful questions that were submitted earlier, but I want to make sure everybody has this link to our website, which provides a lot of helpful guidance in this area. I'm also including my email address and phone number. Feel free to contact me with questions, with complaints. Some of our, you know, because these claims are so hard for consumers to evaluate, the most valuable complaints that we get are often from competitors who are best situated to know what's going on in your industry. So it's always something that we're interested in as well. Thank you so much for tuning in today.
Julia, thank you so much for that very informative presentation. We're going to turn to the Q&A section of the webinar now, and we're going to go through with you the questions that have been submitted previously from today's attendees. We've tried to group the questions by theme, so that would makes it easier and more efficient in terms of answering them. The first question has to do with the level of evidentiary proof or substantiation that should be kept in a company's files to support a Made in USA claim. Specifically, how much documentation should be obtained from parts, components, and ingredient suppliers? Finally, as part of that question, there was a recent closing letter that your office issued, and it's on your website, I believe. It was issued to a major retailer, and it appears that as part of the closing letter, a type of Made in USA compliance program was crafted and implemented by the company. So the question is, how does your office view this type of compliance program?
Sure. So again, when we're talking about substantiation for U.S. origin claims, we're talking about a reasonable basis for the claim. We don't tell marketers or companies exactly what substantiation they need to maintain. It's up to the company to figure out how they want to substantiate their claims. We don't dictate anything in particular. There are examples in the enforcement policy statements of certifications that marketers might consider getting from suppliers and folks that provide inputs to products. That's one possible way that marketers could think about substantiating the claim and maintaining paperwork in their files. But if we end up opening an investigation into your claim or your product, we will look at whatever you maintain. There's nothing in specific that we expect that you need to have in your file. You will be responsible for going as far back in the manufacturing chain as you need to fully understand the inputs to your product. In terms of corrective action plans that are in the closing letters on the public record, typically the corrective action plans that you'll see referenced in those letters are proposed by the targets of the investigation by the recipient. We don't dictate a particular corrective action plan. We look to companies to figure out ways to come into compliance with the law. So, you know, something like a compliance program or something like that is interesting, and it might be very helpful to bring a company into compliance and ensure ongoing compliance, but it's certainly not something that we would require or expect to see in every instance. I should also mention that the closing letters are staff closing letters. So again, they represent the opinions of the staff of the enforcement division. They're not binding on the commission.
Okay, that's very helpful. You, during the presentation and in some previous discussions that we've had with you, you've used a phrase that I found very interesting, which is doing the right thing. And you've made it pretty clear that the commission is not, or your office is not interested in basically punishing companies that it considers to be doing the right thing. You know, sometimes mistakes are made, you have perhaps conflicting information on a product, and it's a, you know, an innocent error. So thinking about that term, doing the right thing, can you share with us and today's attendees what kind of company conduct resonates with your office in the context of a Made in USA investigation of a company doing the right thing, but still getting it wrong?
Well, so it's all on the spectrum, and the question I think also relates to the degree of deception and what's going on with a particular product. If we're talking about a product where the proportion of U.S. manufacturing costs and foreign manufacturing costs is, you know, the balance is 50-50 or something like that, and the company has made some efforts to, in some places on their website, disclose that they do incorporate foreign inputs where they have to and things like that. I think attempts to qualify claims in general, awareness that they need to tip consumers off to the fact that their products incorporate significant imported content, I think things like that usually indicate that a company is trying to disclose to consumers that their products may not meet consumer expectation. I mean, the opposite example would be, for example, a company that wholly imports products, peels off country of origin labels that were on the products when they came in the U.S. and replaces them with Made in USA stickers. I think in that case, it's obvious that the company is, you know, not trying to comply with the law, is trying to pull the wool over consumers' eyes. Of course, intent is not an element. I mean, it's not relevant to the Section 5 analysis, or it's not dispositive, but in this area, we try to operate from the assumption that companies want to comply with the law. We're very sensitive to making sure that companies can promote the good work that they're doing in the U.S. We just need to make sure that they aren't deceiving people in the process.
Thank you. Thank you, Julia. We'll move to another topic, and that is percentage of U.S. content and percentage of foreign content. We get this question quite a bit, and there were several questions that came in through the attendees today. So, in terms of threshold percentages, is there a set percentage, for example, of U.S. content that can be achieved to reach the all or virtually all standard? And on the other side of the coin, what's the percentage threshold that FTC would consider below the negligible or de minimis standard for foreign content? For example, on the state level, California has a 5% safe harbor built into its statute. And customs, you know, U.S. customs may also have some, you know, like a 7% de minimis rule applying to certain origin issues. So we were wondering if the FTC can comment on the percentage thresholds, both of foreign and U.S. content.
So again, I have to emphasize, I can't speak for the FTC. I can only speak for myself. But what I can tell you is that the commission has never articulated a bright line rule in terms of a percentage cutoff. So there is no set percentage of cost that must be attributable to either U.S. or foreign manufacturing costs. And the reason for that is because, again, we're very tied to consumer perception. Our analysis always starts from how would a reasonable consumer understand the claim. And in cases where the percentage of costs that are attributable to U.S. marketing costs or U.S. manufacturing costs is very high. In some cases, the foreign content that is in the product is so important to the function of the product, is so essential to the character of the product, that consumers associate the product with that foreign input. So to make an unqualified claim for the product would likely deceive consumers, because when consumers think of the product, they're thinking of that particular foreign input. Costs simply don't always tell the whole story. The reason that people often import certain inputs is because it's cheaper to do so. So it simply doesn't tell the whole story. There's no bright line rule.
Okay, that's helpful. So just by way of example, if you had a foreign component, the only foreign component was about 2% of the wholesale value of the product, yet it had such a significant impact in terms of the functionality of the product, that inverse relationship, low cost but very high significance, that's a very important factor that FTC looks at?
It is, and I think you can make it concrete by thinking about yourself as a consumer. And think of, I don't know, any widget. And if you identify, before you think about the cost, identify to yourself, what is it about this widget that makes the widget the widget, the thing that makes the thing the thing? And then ask yourself, if you were to find out that that part or that input were imported, would you feel deceived by an unqualified claim for the product? And I think you'll find, if you think about it that way, that the cost analysis drops away, because you say, hey, yeah, that's the fundamental essence of the product. When I think about the product, that's what I identify the product with. The costs don't tell the whole story.
Okay. So just one further question about percentage of U.S. content, and this goes to doing the actual calculations. A question came in about, when you do the computation, do you base it on the wholesale price, the wholesale value, or the retail price? And also, does labor, I assume U.S. labor, count towards that U.S. content?
The enforcement policy statement provides that manufacturers should use as their measure the cost of goods sold or finished inventory cost, as those terms are used in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. In general, those costs include the cost of manufacturing materials, direct manufacturing labor, and manufacturing overhead.
Thank you.
Julia, you mentioned a very interesting concept, which is somewhat esoteric, and I know that a lot of companies are attempting to grapple with it. And it's really this concept that perhaps not all components or ingredients are viewed equally in a product, that some, perhaps depending on their purpose or functionality, play a more important part in a consumer's perception than others. So we get a lot of questions like that. Is there a way that you could give us a couple of examples of how that sort of purpose or functionality concept is applied, in your office? Actually, to make it easier, I might be able to give you a specific example that somebody submitted, and maybe we could use that as a springboard here. And that is, in the case of heavy machinery, engines, aerospace equipment, tractors, or other large manufactured items with a huge array of parts and components and very complex assembly and manufacturing operations. Do you have any recommendations on how a company can attempt to make a determination as to which components may be considered significant and important to the function of the finished item? Is there some subjectivity involved in this analysis?
Certainly there's subjectivity, and in most cases we would look to the target of the investigation or the company to tell us what the important parts were and how the parts function and what they do. But again, we are tied to consumer perception, so the best way to figure out how consumers interpret your claim and whether consumers are deceived by your claim is to do consumer perception testing to get the answer from consumers themselves. We do the best that we can with the consumer perception testing that's been provided. The enforcement policy statement encapsulates some of that consumer perception testing and commission experience, but the most persuasive thing to us is always consumer perception tests. So if you have evidence that shows that consumers interpret claims a particular way for your product, that's always going to be helpful to our analysis. But I think in general, you know, something like a screw or something like that is obviously going to be less important than whatever drives your product, if that makes sense.
And staying on the topic of specific components or ingredients, sometimes we get questions, and there are some questions that have been submitted today involving the case where you have things that you cannot source despite your best efforts. You cannot source them in the United States, either because perhaps they're not grown here, such as in the case of certain agricultural products, or they're just, you know, not made here. And the question is what if a manufactured ingredient or component cannot be sourced at all in the U.S. and not just because of cost? Does your office have any sort of policy exception for components that perhaps fall into this category?
There's no exception for components that can't be sourced in the U.S. as a general matter. And the reason for that is the consumer perception testing that we've seen indicates that consumers simply don't take that into account. There's a very limited footnote in the enforcement policy statement pertaining only to raw materials that provides that in some very extremely limited cases where a manufacturer or marketer can show that there's a general understanding among consumers that a particular raw material is not grown or available in the U.S., then the marketer may not need to take that into account when doing this analysis, but it's a very, very limited example, and the marketer would have to do testing or otherwise show that consumers generally understand that the input is not available. The footnote's limited to raw materials, however, not manufactured inputs.
Mm-hmm. And can you share with us whether there have been any raw materials that have fallen into that category?
I am not aware of any consumer perception testing on this, no.
Okay, okay. I seem to recall something about vanilla beans, which of course is incredibly limited and a very discreet.
You're asking what the example, what the actual
yes.
raw material was that's referenced in the example. Yeah, the
yes.
example seems to assume that consumers generally understand that vanilla beans are not grown in the U.S. You know, whether consumers understand that or not, I don't really know. But yes, vanilla beans are mentioned in the example.
The next couple of questions concern foreign components and how to
sorry,
recycle.
Sorry, can I jump back? Can I just jump back to that question for a
sure.
second? I did also want to flag to folks, though, that the example does say that even if a raw material is non-indigenous and the manufacturer can show that people generally understand that, if that imported material does constitute the whole or essence of the finished product, so we're talking like rubber in a rubber ball or coffee beans in ground coffee, it may still mislead consumers to label the final product as an unqualified claim. So if that raw material is the entire product, just because people understand, I mean, it would be weird to label it as made in USA.
Okay, thank you. So the next couple of questions have to do with foreign components and sourcing and so on, and I'll just go right to it here. So a particular company imports components or ingredients from several suppliers, both domestic and imported, depending upon availability and price. So it's possible at one time of the year, one ingredient is from a particular ingredient is from a U.S. source. At another time, it might be from an imported source, and this could change quite frequently. So the question is, how is this viewed by FTC, and would it be possible? Another question came in: would it be possible to use, for example, a standard qualified label indicating made in USA with foreign ingredients, even if some of the ingredients may be of U.S. origin on occasion, under the scenario where it varies from time to time?
So there's no required way to handle this. Again, the company has an obligation not to deceive consumers. So if the company wants to use a standard qualified label indicating made in USA with foreign ingredients, even if sometimes all the ingredients in the product are of U.S. origin, although technically in the case of products that contain all U.S. origin ingredients that may deceive consumers and very technically violate Section 5, I, as a staff attorney in this area, would never recommend enforcement for a claim like that. I think if you're going to err on the side of deception, what I've seen about how these claims are material to consumers would indicate that the safer way is to err on disclosing the possibility of the foreign content. So I think that if the commission were to ask me what I thought about that claim in that particular instance, I would never recommend enforcement action. I would have a hard time seeing how enforcement action would proceed on a claim like that. So I think my informal staff feedback to a company that has this situation would be either you need to go through an exercise where you're updating your claims frequently when you have fluctuations in the manufacturing chain. If you're intent on capturing all of those fluctuations in your claims, then you're going to need to update all the time. However, if you think it's less burdensome for you and it's your preference to employ this qualified claim that would capture, I guess what I would call it, the least common denominator in terms of U.S. content, I think that, in my view, that would be an acceptable way to proceed.
That's very helpful. So another question concerning foreign components. One of the attendees is asking about a product that is viewed as a kit. So it's an assembly of U.S.-made products, which the company indicates would form the essential character of the whole kit. But it also has some foreign accessories that are imported along with the kit that carry very high values. So how, I guess this goes to the other issue about an inverse relationship between value and function. So how might FTC view something like that in terms of made in USA?
Well, I think that we're likely to analyze the kit the way that we would analyze any other multi-input products. So we would employ the flexible factors analysis. In a case where the essential inputs are of U.S. origin, but there are foreign components that carry a high value and account for a high proportion of the manufacturing costs, I think that would probably tip the analysis over to analysis of manufacturing costs. We've seen a lot of consumer perception evidence about how consumers interpret claims for products with varying percentages of costs attributable to U.S. versus foreign manufacturing costs. So in those studies, the importance of the foreign content itself is less important to consumers than that cost analysis. So I think in this example where the importance of the foreign content to the function of the product is smaller, but the proportion of costs attributable to the foreign parts is high, that would probably tip the balance over to a qualified claim for the product.
Thank you.
Julia, let's shift gears for a moment and talk about packaging and the role of packaging in a Made in USA analysis. Many consumer goods are sold in any number of packaging configurations. There's typically, you have your finished product, you have some sort of inner packaging. You might have outer packaging, which is usually the retail box. You might even have a shipping box for transport, depending on how the item is being ordered and how it arrives at the consumer. So knowing that there's lots of packaging involved in the presentation of a finished product, what role does the packaging play when conducting an FTC all or virtually all made in USA analysis?
In general, when we've looked at product packaging, we have taken the position that if the product packaging is something that the consumer is going to discard, then that's probably not something the consumer takes into account when they're analyzing a U.S. origin claim for the product. There have been two general exceptions in how we've thought about this. So one exception would be if there's something about the claim itself that makes it sound like it refers to the product packaging, then obviously the packaging would need to be a part of the analysis. So for example, if the claim on the box were something like everything in this product down to the cardboard box it's delivered in is all made in the U.S., obviously that's a very specific claim that pulls packaging into it. And in that case, we would be looking at the origin of the packaging as well. The other exception would be for products where the packaging is somehow collectible. I think for whatever reason, the example that's often been thrown around here is perfume bottles that seem to have some sort of value to consumers apart from the perfume itself. I guess there are people that collect a lot of these bottles, and so part of their purchasing decision when they're looking at the perfume might be the beauty or the collectibility of the bottle itself. In that case, because the consumer would consider the bottle as part of the product, then we would likely analyze the origin of the packaging for that type of a product.
Okay, that's helpful. And one of the specific examples that one of the attendees submitted is this example. If a U.S. company makes a candle using domestic wax, fragrance, colorant, and wicks from U.S. suppliers, but uses an inexpensive commodity glass jar from elsewhere, is it still possible to claim made in the USA? And would the analysis be similar to the perfume bottle example?
So I haven't seen specific consumer perception testing on how consumers understand claims for candles. If I were just thinking about this, it seems to me that the bottle for a candle is different from the either the perfume bottle or the disposable packaging. It seems to me that as opposed to those examples, the glass jar is actually part of the product itself. I mean, you can't really have the candle without it being contained in the jar. I mean, it seems to me in that case, it's actually part of the product itself. Of course, consumer perception evidence would rule the day here, and consumers often understand things differently than I think they will. Usually, I think consumers are going to be more accepting of foreign inputs than they actually are. In general, I found that consumers have very low tolerance for foreign content in products with unqualified claims. But, you know, who knows? I think in this case, if a company called me and asked for my informal staff feedback, my feedback would be that I think it's better to disclose that the glass jar is imported just because it seems like it's part of the product itself. But the company might want to conduct consumer perception evidence to confirm that.
Great, thank you. So let's move to some questions concerning specific claims and permutations of different claims and statements made in connection with Made in USA. So the first question is an interesting one. Can a product with imported components be labeled as Made in USA with global materials? How would the FTC view the term global, and how might that claim be viewed with respect to different industries? Is there a distinction, for example, electronics, software, aerospace, heavy equipment, and so on, in terms of using that type of claim.
So for any, again, for any qualified claim, the first question or the first hurdle is substantial transformation. So the product with the imported components has to be less substantially transformed in the U.S. before it can carry any type of U.S. origin claim qualified or other ways. Assuming that this product was substantially transformed in the U.S., I haven't seen consumer perception testing on made in USA with global materials. I would not recommend enforcement action for that claim for a product that was substantially transformed in the U.S. that incorporated imported components. So to me, it seems like that claim likely fulfills the goal of tipping consumers off to the fact that the product contains significant imported components. But, you know, I could be wrong about that. In terms of how the claim is viewed with respect to different industries, again, without consumer perception testing, it's really almost impossible for us to know whether consumers would understand the claim differently for electronics, airplanes, or anything else. My inclination would not be to recommend enforcement action on this claim for products across a range of industries as long as the product is substantially transformed in the U.S. But, you know, if someone out there has consumer perception evidence showing me that I'm wrong or that that claim does deceive consumers, obviously I'd be interested in seeing that.
Okay. What about design claims? One of the attendees submitted a question concerning how your office would view claims such as designed in the USA or designed in New York, either in conjunction with another origin claim or as a standalone claim. As part of that question, there's a section concerning what about claims of a more abstract origin, such as made locally?
So I actually think the analysis for those two claims is pretty different. So designed in the USA claim is, I think, outside of the ambit of the enforcement policy statement. I would look at that as a general marketing claim to be analyzed under Section 5 of the FTC Act. And the questions that the manufacturers would need to ask there, you know, how would a consumer, what does it mean to a consumer for a product to be designed in the USA? I wouldn't look particularly for substantial transformation in the US or anything like that. I would not view a designed in the USA claim as akin to a qualified US origin claim. I would look at it as simply that, a designed in the USA claim where the question is, would consumers agree with you that the product is designed in the US? So that's how I would think about that claim, would be general to Section 5, not specific under the enforcement policy statement. Of course, if that claim is combined with a different US origin claim, so if it said designed in the USA, made in the USA, then I would probably think about pulling those claims apart, analyzing the designed in the USA claim generally under Section 5 and then the made in USA claim under the enforcement policy statement. In terms of claims that are more local, like made in New York or made locally, I would consider those to be unqualified US origin claims. I would look through the guidance in the enforcement policy statement and for those products to comply with the all or virtually all guidance. How specific the origin has to be or the percentage of the work that goes into the product that actually has to take place in New York City or wherever it is, I don't know the answer to that consumer perception question, but the first step would certainly be to analyze these, I think, as unqualified U.S. origin claims.
Thank you. The next question actually has to do with textile and apparel labeling, and I know that there is a separate statute and a set of regulations that deal with that, but let's just cover it because we do have many textile and apparel companies joining us today. And one of the questions is it a common practice within the clothing and apparel industry for products that may be 49% foreign content and 51% domestic content to actually be marketed as completely made in the USA with no qualifying language. So I guess they're asking specifically, I guess, under the Textile Act, how that might apply and whether there's any interplay with the enforcement policy and the Textile Act.
So I don't know what is a common practice within the clothing and apparel industry, but what I can tell you is that the cost analysis that goes into complying with the enforcement policy statement does not occur typically under the Textile Act and textile rules. So particular textile products are subject to the Textile Act and textile rules. For those products, there is a requirement that companies disclose the country of origin on the labels for those products. When you're thinking about country of origin, the Textile Act and textile rules provide that if you want to use the U.S. origin claim, you need to follow what's called the one-step removed rule. Actually, when I think about it, it seems more like two steps to me, but I think an example to help you understand that would be, say that you sell wool socks and the fact pattern is you import wool, you spin the wool into yarn in the U.S., and then you knit that yarn into the sock in the U.S. This one or two, however you think about it, step removed rule in the Textile Act and textile rules would say you look at where that knitting process occurred, and then the process before that, so the process where the wool was turned into yarn. Because both of those processes occurred in the United States, you could label the sock as made in the USA without qualification. So that analysis doesn't take into account costs or things like that. If we were looking at this product from the enforcement policy perspective, it would be like, whoa, 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 all of the raw materials that are going into this sock, the things that give the sock the fundamental character are all imported. You need to disclose that. But that's not the analysis for products that are subject to Textile Act, textile rules, or I guess the sock would be the wool rules, but it's the same. So that's kind of how to think about it. The first step, if you make a textile product, a wool product, check those rules to see whether your product is included or accepted from those rules. If you're included, then you would follow this different analysis.
Thank you for clarifying that. And we will be addressing textile issues in future webinars, and that's helpful. So another quick question is, what about the use of the term printed in USA? Is it only appropriate to call out the print where the print has special significance, for example, if a product is a book or stationery? And what about printing on the product itself? Can that be called out and added to an existing origin claim? So for example, made and printed in USA.
Well, again, I think printed in the USA is a general advertising claim under Section 5. It's not really an enforcement policy statement claim. Again, the question would be consumer perception and how consumers understand printed in the U.S. I don't really have any feedback on that claim without thinking about a specific product or something like that. It's hard to know how consumers would understand the claim.
Okay, I think we have time maybe for one more question, and this has to do with a claim assembled in USA. So in terms of products that may be assembled in the U.S. but have that it's constructed entirely of foreign components, is that an acceptable claim?
The enforcement policy statement provides that as long as you're substantially transforming the product in the U.S., that there's more than a screwdriver assembly, that there's no finishing process that goes on overseas, then assembled in the USA would likely not deceive consumers for a product that contains all imported parts.
Julia, we would like to thank you for your participation in our kickoff webinar. We are, I believe, almost at 3 o'clock, and we promised you and the other attendees that we would not run over. I would like to also personally thank my colleague Scott Cohn and my colleagues here at Arent Fox in the marketing and the IT groups who worked very hard to help us pull all this together and get about 250 people on a phone call and not have any background noise and not have the system crash. And we would like to finally thank members of the audience who tuned in today. Mark your calendars for our next legal series on Made in USA, our next webinar, and the date, once again, is May 17th. And you can see what we'll be addressing in the bullets, some of the special rules that are accepted under the enforcement policy. We will be examining some of the nuances in terms of differences between California standards and the FTC. And finally, we'll be looking at some of the cost accounting analyses that should be done for components. Thank you very much, and have a terrific rest of the week. Goodbye.